Hello, friends. Welcome back to the podcast. Just a couple of things before we get started. We're now on Spotify. I've seen the messages and the comments like, hey, when are you guys going to be on Spotify? And I just want to remind you guys, we're finally there. So thank you to everybody who's already subscribed and been listening to us on Spotify. I see the numbers running up and I greatly appreciate that. So just for everybody who missed the announcement, we're now on Spotify. Go listen to us there. It's awesome. And also, everybody who's asking how they can support the podcast outside of just listening and subscribing, you can head over to jamierk.com/shop and pick up the hottest merch in the game. It's always selling like a god shirt. And I just want to thank my buddy John. Shout out the Conco. He designs everything. All the stuff that you see in that shop has been designed by him. Super awesome stuff. So I greatly appreciate him doing all my artwork. And also I want to shout out Printhead. It's run by Cole from NorCal. He plays in some awesome bands. I'm sure you guys know about him. But I worked with him on the last design and he did a really great job with everything, all aspects. Great customer service. Turnaround time was amazing. So if you can support Printhead, awesome, awesome shop. But my guest today, Shane Moran, sang for Bad Seed, plays guitar in Title Fight, has a new project coming out under the moniker Poison Thorn. He does Happy House, just a ton of awesome stuff. I'm happy to be able to call him a friend, and the podcast we did was amazing. I had a really great time talking to him and diving deep on a lot of stuff that we both have been wanting to talk about. So it was such an awesome time for me, and seriously, I hope you guys listen to this podcast, and I hope you guys listen to his bands, support him any way you can. He's a great dude. So without further ado, welcome Shane to the podcast. Welcome to the podcast, Shane.
Hey, thanks for having me.
I'm a fan. Dude, thank you so much. If I'm going to be honest, when we first started talking and you told me that you listened to the podcast, I was blown away.
Yeah, well, you interview like mad people from Wilkes-Barre, Nate, Caleb, Pete, Dan, right? Is there anybody else?
I did Ryan.
Oh, yeah. So, yeah, shout out all those guys.
Yeah. Yeah. Shout out to Nate Prosciutti because it all started with him. I reached out, and this is crazy because I reached out to Nate through Facebook of like all places, right? I reached out to Nate and he was just super down to do it from the beginning and just a really nice guy in general. And he just put me on to everybody from out there and it just kind of grew and everybody, not even just from that area, just like the whole state has just been super supportive of like what I've been doing.
Yeah. Nate's a cool guy. He's kind of spearheading some of the, I don't want to say new generation because he's been around since I've started going to shows, but you know what I'm saying? Wilkes-Barre's got like a crop of new younger bands and there's like a local venue and Nate's doing Choice to Make and 1240 and all that. So it's cool. It's like it feels like a new chapter and yeah, it's cool to keep an eye on it, keep tabs on it. And yeah, I like listening to those conversations for sure.
Yeah. And I definitely appreciate that. And I've always been a fan of, your guys' scene out there. Obviously, I feel like it was like pretty, big on the map. Like a lot of people paying attention to all the bands coming out of there. Then it felt like for a little while that there was like kind of like a lull, but now there's just a crop of great bands coming out and especially like, you know, One Step Closer, you know, doing stuff worldwide, which is insane and awesome for them. So it's something cool to see that scene just kind of like, you know, bounce back into the spotlight.
Yeah, man, I feel like it's gone in waves from like being really intense and then kind of these weird lulls, like you're saying. But yeah, right now is like a cool, very fertile time for our scene at home. And yeah, I'm just super happy to be a part of it. I'm always super proud whenever, you know, One Step Closer, Warn, or Choice to Make, Acupuncture. There's a bunch of cool young bands, younger bands with a mix, a range of young people and older people. So yeah, just keeping the wheels turning and just adding, building upon like the history that we have here. And something that like is really important to me because it completely like altered the course of my life for the better, I think. And just having like a community, a small community like that where we're from, yeah, it just, I think it opens a lot of people's minds, and it just gives people a platform and a space to just explore music and art and community. And yeah, it's just, it's one of the things that like keeps me here. Like I still live in the area. So yeah, it's a positive, good thing.
And you're like obviously tied to some pretty prominent bands from your area. And I know you're super artistic. I was just curious, like, where did all this start?
Yeah, so I guess it would start with, I mean, me like personally, probably would start around the time I met like some of the guys in Title Fight. But that was like there was like a precedent already, like with where we're from. And there, you know, when I first started getting into music, I was probably like, when I was seriously getting into music and guitar, skateboarding and all those things kind of happening at the same time, I was probably in middle school, like maybe like sixth grade or something like that, seventh grade, I started getting really into music. And there's bands like on MTV or like Blink-182 and Newfound Glory and that type of, like those type of pop punk bands and stuff. And I kind of started to discover those things. And like, that was sort of, I don't know, I kind of think about that a lot. Like what was it about that stuff that like drew me towards it, you know? But when I think about it, I think a lot of my story comes from like just being always like having someone to kind of look up to and be inspired by. And I think initially it was my two older sisters. There I have a lot of brothers and sisters, but my two older sisters were I don't know, they're, when I was like young, I was just always looking up to them and what they were doing, who they were hanging out with. Their boyfriends always like had a really big impact on me. And actually one of my sister's boyfriends, like before I was even into like MTV pop punk, like one of my sister's boyfriends was like a hardcore guy. And I remember like him giving me a ride so to wherever I was going. I don't remember, like a middle school dance or something. And he had like, he was into hardcore, and there'd be like Chain of Strength tapes like on the floor of his Volkswagen Corrado. He's like a weird like car guy, hardcore kid. And just like weird little things like that kind of like got me hip to like knowing, like I thought I knew what hardcore was initially just because of little things like that at a really young age. And then there's this, yeah, so I guess there was like a weird little precedent there from things like that being rubbed off on me from people who I was close with. And then when I was in middle school, like I said, I was like getting more into like Blink-182, Green Day, that type of shit. And but like at that same time, I discovered that there was a local scene too. And I think that's like the thing that kind of changed everything, because I was like, it went very quickly from like 1 month being like, whoa, like these bands are cool, like I can relate to this, like I think I might be able to like do this for myself, to then like learning about our local scene, which was like, at the time there was a band called Frostbite that was probably like the biggest local hardcore band. And it's kind of like some guys like pre-Cold World sort of, but super like good hardcore band. They're like one of my favorite hardcore bands today still. So there's like that band and our scene, yeah, our local scene, there's just a scene here. And so I think kind of learning about music like in this grand scale from like in the mainstream way, and then also learning like almost like at the same time, like there's this local scene and that exists. And like all of a sudden it was like accessible to me to maybe like have a platform to do the things I was like dreaming about in my bedroom, you know, for myself. So so that's kind of like the backdrop of like what was happening. And it was probably around like 2003 or 2004 or something like that. And I was like kind of like directionless, like, you know, just kind of into everything that I could get my hands on that I could hear in like a skate video or like video games or whatever. And I was looking at this message board for I found out about this message, like a website. It wasn't really a message board. It was kind of a message board. It was called homebaseshows.com. And it was a website that was like for this old venue that used to be in Wilkes-Barre called Homebase. But they would list like all local shows, like in venues, any venue in close proximity would like get a listing on there. And then there was like a little like chat, like area that you could engage and like kind of like pre MySpace type of stuff. So I would like always look at that site because it was always really fascinating to me, because it was like these like local characters would like be posting, you know, in the comments, and then you could just check out listings for like shows that were happening locally. And I remember one of them was a show, like there was show listings, and then it would have like a little description of like the bands and then a little description of the band. It was just like a flyer basically, but just in text format. And I can't remember which show it was, but I remember reading the one, and it was like there was a advertisement for a show for a band called Title Fight, and it said, the description under it was like, Kingston Youth, enough said. And I was like, yo, like I'm from Kingston, like what is, and I'm like young, I'm in middle school, like what is this, you know what I mean? And I got like super excited. I was like, damn, like maybe there's like other kids like me that are like into guitar and skateboarding or whatever that, you know, like I need to like go to this. I need to find like these people or like check this out, because this is like 100% like up my alley. You know what I mean? And being from our area, like we had a vibrant scene too, but like you still like go to school and like there wasn't like, I still kind of felt like a little bit of an outsider, you know? So it was like I was still kind of searching for my people a little bit. So I can't remember, like I think I went to that show and I ended up meeting like everybody that was in Title Fight, which was just Ned, Ben, and Jamie at that time. And it's funny because I had like previously already met Ned and Ben and didn't know, like we played on a mini basketball team at the Kingston Rec Center, like when they were even like, it was like, I can't remember. I think maybe they were in like fourth or fifth grade and I was in sixth grade, and we had like played on the same team together, but like I think we were too young and like awkward to really like hit it off, you know? But I remember like talking to Ned cause he wore like a Blink-182 shirt, or like, I think I rode my skateboard to basketball practice one time and, or like was wearing Vans or something. And like, we just like talked about it, you know? So it was like kind of this funny small world thing that after I went to the show, I was like, oh, like I already know these guys kind of, like, you know. And then from there, we just kind of hit it off and we just started like hanging out all the time, skating, and Title Fight was doing a bunch of, they always had something going on, like practicing or trying to record demos or whatever. Yeah. So, yeah, I just started like kicking it with those guys, and then slowly we just like got closer and closer, and like we started, like there's another band that we started that I like sang for. It was like more like a hardcore band, and like that was kind of like slowly integrating me into the fold a little bit more. And then like in 2005 they just because it just made sense, because I was like at all the recordings, at all the practices or whatever, you know, they're just like, yo, you play guitar or whatever, so do you want to, these new songs we're writing have like two guitar parts in them. Like, do you want to play guitar? I was like, hell yeah. Like at the time I couldn't believe, like Title Fight was like my favorite band at that time. They did like a demo in 2004. And I think you might be able to still find it online, but it was just like, it to this day, it's like still my favorite Title Fight shit. It's like, so like when I listen to it, it's like trips me out. It's like this weird like experience. And the song's just super good and like sophisticated for being little kids, and I was like, it was my favorite thing. And to like be asked to join it at that time, I was like, couldn't believe it, you know? And then from there, like my whole life, I think, has kind of like revolved around that, you know?
So thank you for that. That was really awesome to hear. But I want to go back to that website. How did you even discover something like that? Because that's back when you said before MySpace. So I'm just curious, how did a young kid from Kingston find a website that actually, you know, facilitated like these flyer type things to help promote the local shows?
I don't know. I can't remember. But at that time, it's like you'd go to like the mall and there'd be like people flyering, you know? Okay. For shows, like hardcore kids would just like come up to you if you looked like kind of like different, you know, and like, or like maybe it was from my sisters, or at that time, like just skating like around the neighborhood, like kids that skated were kind of hip to like punk and hardcore and stuff like that. So I think probably, you know what I mean? I was just like in the streets, and like probably just one thing led to another. And at the time, like there was also a website that was like a little bit after that called iHeartMook.com, which is like this kid, he's not a kid, he's like an older friend of mine. He was like putting on shows and just organizing the scene in a way. And there was like a message board on that website that was like really big. And like there was a couple of kids in my high school that were into hardcore and punk and stuff, but it kind of took a second to like earn their respect maybe, or like connect the dots. But maybe through one of them, they like just put me on, or like, yo, check out this website. I don't know. I can't remember. But yeah, there was message boards that were like super lively. Like it was crazy. I remember just lurking them as like a 12-year-old, being like so enamored by like, not only was there like a place that I could go to like maybe like play music, or even just go watch bands, like whether locally or touring bands or whatever, but like not only that, with like there was a venue that was like this weird central hub called Cafe Metropolis, which is like, when I think about it now, it's like something out of like the Twilight Zone or like Twin Peaks or something, the way it looked and like the cast of characters that ran it. And then there's just like people, like, I don't know, just like heads, you know what I mean? People that were like in the scene and on message boards and had like an identity, and people respected them, and they had opinions, and people would talk shit and they would talk about their favorite bands and all that type of thing, you know? So it was like, I don't really know how I found it, but like that was like before MySpace for sure. There was like, that stuff was still happening. I think at the like punk and hardcore level, like those types of people have always been kind of like more hip to like, I don't know. I feel like they've always been like a little bit like one step ahead of mainstream culture or something with like their connectivity, you know?
Yeah, I think that's awesome. I think back to like those times before social media was a thing, and it was so easy to connect with so many different people. And I think about how much harder it had to have been back in the day for people to keep the scene running, you know, smooth, booking shows, tours, finding out about new music. It's so crazy, like how much harder it was back then. And I like, you know, commend those people who, you know, came before me, because that's just so crazy. Kind of cool to think about too. Just like it being like a little more less primitive.
Yeah, it was like, I don't know, like people in Wilkes-Barre have been organized. Like we've had like fests, like Posse Numbers Fest, like Hardcore Fest. It predates like any hardcore fest you ever heard of in America. Like, I don't know, it was just this weird, I don't know, it doesn't really make sense, because you come here and it's like pretty shot, like it's a dead old coal mining town, you know? But mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of people point to it being like central between Philly and New York, like as this like extra tour stop for bands, like in between those two things. I was just kind of easy and convenient, and for whatever reason, like the people here, like the OGs that we had here, are just like down. Like they're just like knew what they were talking about, knew what they liked, and they like did everything they could to keep it alive and provide like an outlet for kids, you know? And I think maybe it being like a small town like helped, because it's like cheaper to rent out the fire hall. It's cheaper to get whatever little thing you need to like make, you know, in New York City or Philly, maybe those types of things are a little bit like on a grander scale. Like it was, they're happening, you know, those places are super vibrant and still are to this day. But you know what I'm saying? Like it was just like a small town. It was just like, it's kind of easy to just like make something happen like quick on the fly, or like whatever you need to do to just like have a place to do shows, you know? Like even to this day, like the Hive is like the new local venue. And it's like, I don't know, it's so cool to me. It's like carrying that same tradition. It's just like, all right, we don't have a venue, like, let's figure it out. You know, I wasn't really involved in that, but I know the guys that did just like took care of it. And it's like, it's a commitment for sure, but it's like not that crazy. It's like, it's easy to do if you just kind of commit to it and gather, you know, round up the troops and make it happen.
And you speak about posse numbers. Were you ever able to attend that fest when it was still active?
Yeah, I went to like the last one ever, which was in like a sports dome, which actually like's funny because in more recent years, I played soccer there a bunch. Mm-hmm. And like, yeah, so it's 2005. I went to that one. It was like the final posse numbers. And actually like that hardcore band that I mentioned earlier, it was just me singing and the rest of the guys in Title Fight. It was called the Gnarlies. And we ended up adding our friend Saba after a while. But yeah, we played like the pre-posse numbers party in 2015 at Cafe Metro. It was like the day before the fest started. And that was like the biggest accomplishment at that time to do that. So we had like a little bit, like I caught the very tail end of posse numbers. Yeah.
Yeah. It's insane when you go back and search those videos up on YouTube and to think about how many people actually showed up for that fest. I'm always curious, like where the majority of those people came from. Cause I obviously, you know, there's the local scene that's going to show up, but then definitely people traveled for that. So I was always curious, like, man, like it's so crazy to me that people were traveling for Hardcore Fest like way back then. Cause for me, I was like younger. I was still in high school around that time. I couldn't afford to, you know, fly anywhere in the country for a Hardcore Fest.
Yeah. At the time, I think it was like kind of one of the only things like that, you know? And I remember meeting people from like France and like Spain. Like there's, yeah, like people traveled from everywhere at that time, especially. It's like, I think that was, if you wanted to be in a room with like a 1,000 or 2,000 people and watching a hardcore band, like that was probably one of the few places at the time that you can do it, you know? So, shout out Bob Mack.
Oh, and is that the guy who put on the fest?
Yeah, he like put on a bunch of shows. He ran a record label called Walk All Night that put out a ton of really sick hardcore bands. And he kind of like, yeah, him along with a bunch of people, you know, kind of kept shit going for a good while. He's a great guy.
Hell yeah. And it's important to, you know, try those people out, because obviously without them, who knows where the scene would be today, because that history is really important, because to keep a scene, especially like a scene like that doesn't like isn't in a major city or on a coast, those kind of people are really important.
Yeah, man, it's inspiring. And like, yeah, for especially for me, like from my point of view, is like, I don't know like what my outlet would have been otherwise, you know what I mean? And I learned a lot through punk and hardcore, and that like it just opened doors, you know? So I'm always super thankful. Like anybody that's doing that type of thing on any level in their community, like it doesn't have to be punk or hardcore, but if you're committed to like giving someone or younger people an outlet, that's something, you know, super important. I think all communities across the world should be doing that. They should be thinking about their neighbors and their little brothers and sisters. You know what I mean?
Yeah. One thing on this podcast, I always preach about how the youth is really important when it comes to, and I always talk about in hardcore, but that, you know, you can apply that to any other subculture, because they're going to be the ones who are going to be around after we're gone.
Yeah. Yeah. You gotta, I don't know. You gotta put in the effort, because in my opinion, it's like doing that type of stuff is just, that's the thing that leaves an impact way more than like going to some like office job or something, you know? It's like, you're like, who are you serving when you're doing that? You know, to me, it's like people become the people they want to be for the most part when they're like home from their job. And like, yeah, so you know what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, no, I definitely get that. So I want to talk about like my earliest memory of Title Fight, you know, me being on MySpace and just kind of cruising through different bands and stuff and trying to find the newest and cool music that I'm into. I remember finding a video and of you guys playing Warped Tour like way back in the days, like 2007, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, it was, I don't remember which year, but we won one of those Ernie Ball Battle of the Bands, I think probably is what you're talking about. We played like the local, like Wilkes-Barre is really close to Scranton, and there was like a Warped Tour used to always stop pretty much in Scranton. That's probably what you're talking about, I think.
Yeah, no, it's on this person's page on YouTube. I think it's pronounced Faster,
Oh yeah. That's Ben
Fazzer.
Russin.
Oh, really? Oh, okay. Yeah,
Yeah.
I literally no idea who ran the page because the video is just up there.
Yeah, it's Ben.
Okay.
He's got some cool video. He just uploaded a recent one with him and his girlfriend, 7 year anniversary. I just was talking to Ben about this like an hour ago. It's funny.
That's
Yeah,
wild.
go check out his page.
All right, yeah, I'm definitely post a link to that. But yeah, so watching that video and you guys won that local thing, but just watching the crowd way back then and seeing kids going nuts and there actually being a decent sized crowd for you guys that early on, it was like crazy for me because I'm like, dang, like who is this band? And like I'd see people like talking about it, and I was like, oh, I was like, all right, like they sound kind of cool, but like who knows if I'll ever get to see them. So, can you talk about if you even remember like what it was like way back then for you guys to play Warped Tour so early on?
It's funny because I think at the time, like that was like one of like it's it appeared to be like that was an important step we should be trying to take, which is really funny looking back now. It's like I don't think it's probably did anything for us really, but at the time, yeah, we're just like any like opportunity to like level up or like go harder, like we wanted to do. So I remember I was talking to Ben about this recently, actually, here, like, for refresh my memory, that I think we like recorded, like, we like went to the studio to record like two new demos, like, specifically for that shit. And I think 1 year, like, we lost 1 year, and then the following year, we're like, all right, we gotta do this because, like, this is a big deal, and like, it would be whatever. Like, maybe we, I don't know, we were just like trying to connect the dots slowly, you know, and thought maybe it would like open up a door to like maybe be able to put out a 7-inch with like a label, or I don't know, I don't even remember the timeline. We might have put out a 7-inch by then already, but yeah, just anything to kind of like grow beyond our little town was like that was the mission. We're just like, all right, like let's get it, you know what I mean? And we had like for being like a small local scene, like it's funny, like we start to play shows, and like a lot of the first shows we started to play were outside of Philly in Doylestown, where this band, the Erection Kids, were from. Which later it was like it's basically just Balancing Composure before Balancing Composure. And we'd drive down to Doylestown, which was like 2 hours pretty much from Wilkes-Barre, and like we'd have like a caravan of like I don't even remember how many kids, we were like 30 kids from Wilkes-Barre just like pulling up, like our friends. And that's just like what we did. Like those were all our homies, and we just go and like mob the place out, and like, you know, people would go off and like because they were just down. They liked the music, and like I think everyone just kind of believed in it, and like that was our time to like have fun, and we just try to maximize, you know what I mean? So I think Warped Tour was like a similar thing. We're just like, let's just like do this and fucking stunt and like I don't know. I mean that's like how I remember it, but I think looking like as kids, you're a lot more naive, and like you're just trying to like do like strive for whatever might be possible to like bring that into your orbit to make it like a reality. You know what I mean? So we just like I don't know. We just had a cool like crew that like supported us, and that definitely empowered us to like it gave us confidence when we went to the Doylestown. It gave us confidence that the Warped Tour, Ernie Ball shit. Like we're just like yeah, like this is us. Like it's not just the band, it's like our friends, it's we're repping like where we're from, like all that.
And I think that's really awesome because I can't think of any video online of Title Fight and you guys having a bad set. So for it to go so far back and you guys having that support all the way through your guys' career, that's just really awesome to see.
Yeah, I mean for sure there was shows that sucked, and like even before like you know, our friends got organized, and like, I don't know. It's hard to really think about it. I can't really speak for like how everyone else felt, but I think it was just a cool coming of age time where like everyone was getting into the music and the music was slowly getting a little bit better. And like we were starting to really fuck with hardcore and like the idea of like having a crazy set, like that shit didn't really happen. Like, I feel like, I don't know, like now it's like stage dives and like all this shit is like such a mainstream, like standard thing. But like we would just like, I don't know, like we just like wanted shit to just go crazy, like because it was rare and like people like responded to that and like it was such a positive, like empowering, magical thing, you know. And I don't know, there's definitely a time like before, like people, like before we were old enough to like know like that moshing was cool, you know what I mean? Like there's definitely lulls and like weird, and that's just, and that also that's just like locally, like when we started touring, like there was years and years of like nobody giving a fuck, you know. I think we had a little bit better than some bands in some ways, but we definitely had that period where like we played to nobody or played to a dead room. Like that shit for sure happened, you know. But like as far as being close to home, like nah, we had to come correct.
So my first time ever seeing Title Fight live, it was Sound and Fury 2009, and I'll never forget this. It was so, like, you know, it was kind of a big deal, like, for Southern California to have Title Fight come and play the fest. So I was like, all right, this is cool. I'm stoked to see them. And I'll never forget how many people were just packed into that venue, because it was at this place in Oxnard, and I can't remember. I never remember the name of the venue because it was only there that one year. But yeah, I just remember everybody packed in, and then there was this guy. I don't even know who it was, but he, like, stage dove before the set even started. It was just still all quiet, and I was like that's wild, this set is gonna be insane. And it, like, seeing you guys live for that first time, it just like blew my mind. I was like, all right, this band is definitely awesome and I'm definitely hooked. So I just will never forget that set. It was just like seriously so impactful for me.
Yeah, I think that was probably Tim Riley. Yeah, the Sound of Fury was like, yeah, it was huge. Like, to getting to California was a huge step, but then also like Sound of Fury being like the standard, like, you know what I mean? You just like, it just like certified you as a band in a way. And like, obviously you got to play to a shit ton of people, and like, it, yeah, like we were just like, at that time, I think we were like starting to really tour and take things seriously. So that was like amazing momentum as a band to like play a show like that. And California is obviously amazing, an amazing place. So yeah, it's good memories. I remember, didn't Trash Talk play out of the U-Haul in the back and stuff like that year?
Yes, they did. Yeah. That was crazy. Somebody jumped off the roof into the crowd, which I thought was really crazy how that person didn't die, because it was pretty high up.
Yeah, it's just cool.
One thing I was always curious about, when it came to Title Fight, obviously you guys are super, you know, tied to the hardcore scene, but Title Fight as a band has been labeled a hardcore band. I was just curious, like, where did that come from, and like, how do you feel about that?
I think it probably comes from just where we're from in Wilkes-Barre. Is like, it's just a hardcore scene, really. Like, Scranton is like the neighboring scene, and it's funny because there's like my girlfriend Brianna plays in Tiger's Jaw, and we've known like bands like the Menzingers, like literally like since the same time I'm saying, like I started getting into Title Fight, like these same bands or these people are like in our orbit as well. And Scranton is more, was like, grew up on like ska almost, you know, their ska shows are like lit. But Wilkes-Barre is always like, for like more or less, was just like a hardcore scene. So I think we always kind of like identified with that. And like Ned and Ben, the two twins in Title Fight, which I feel like are like the organization and like the motivated forces in Title Fight, where like they're little brothers of Alex Russin, who is like our OG. He's like my big brother in a way. He was in Cold World and all the, like, he was in Frostbite to True Identity, all these bands that we grew up just like sweating so hard. And like, I don't know, like we always, like same time Title Fight was happening, there was always like a hardcore band like on the side of it in some way that was like more traditionally a hardcore band, I guess, in the way that it sounded. And that's just like who we identified as, I guess. Like, those are the types of people we were around. Those are largely the types of bands we were listening to for the most part, especially at a local level. Like, there weren't many like alternative or pop punk bands or that whatever type of shit coming through. It was like mostly hardcore scene. So I think that's just like ingrained in us. And yeah, like our, all of like the dudes that would like pass us down shirts or records or like put us on to like different bands were like showing us hardcore bands mostly. And after a while it turned like, I think once maybe Title Fight started to kind of like draw this bridge between what we were doing like more melodically and then with like this hardcore energy or something, and then you know, we got different types of bands to listen to. Like, you know, it went from like Gorilla Biscuits to like, all right, maybe check out like the other ref stuff that's like a little bit more melodic, like Texas Is the Reason or something, or like check out Quicksand, like, you know. So like this type of like lineage or like progression that some of the hardcore bands that we were into had, that I don't know, we just like, I don't know, yeah, I just, we're from Wilkes-Barre, I don't know, you know what I mean? It's like if you come here, it's like you go to a show, it's like, whether it's like, no matter what type of show you're gonna see, I feel like the spirit of hardcore is there. Like the history and the tradition of it is just this really palpable thing. And I think really that's what we were identifying with. And I don't know, that just, yeah, it just gave us this network nationally to like sort of like win people over in a way where it's like there's not really this like nationally organized scene of alternative poppy guitar bands, but there was an organized network of like hardcore kids, you know what I mean? And like when we started touring, like those are the people, those are the scenes that we were like integrating into, you know. And that just like made it even more ripe and like more, felt more like hardcore, you know. We'd go to Long Island or Richmond or Atlanta or, you know, LA or something, and we just meet hardcore kids. Like, I don't know, I think that's like, I don't know, in the van we were just listening to hardcore, you know what I mean? Like, I don't know, I just, yeah, I identify as that. I never like really sweat it too much. Like, I don't care. Like, after a while it just like got annoying to like have to like put any type of label on music or art. But I think that's just like an easy thing for us, is like, yeah, like this is just like what we come from, these are the people we know, these are the bands we like we carry a similar ethos and spirit, I'd like to believe, in the way we carry ourselves as a band, like our philosophy and sonically to a degree. Yeah, but I don't know, I think if anything I was just like hyped to like take that tradition that we like were starting to understand and like just try to make it our own and make it sincere and unique to us or ourselves, you know. So it's just like, yeah, fuck it, like we're a hardcore band, like we don't care like if it sounds different, or because like we come from this shit. Like, you talk to Ned or somebody, he's like, I don't know, he knows more about that shit than most people I know. So it's just like built into who we are, I think.
Hell yeah. I definitely back it, because obviously what you guys have done and where you've come from has been awesome. And I love that the hardcore community in general will support bands like Title Fight and, you know, show them like 100% support and even, you know, try to push them and, you know, prop them up and, you know, try to blow them up as big as they can get. So I definitely back that, and I appreciate the band.
Yeah, I appreciate it too, man. Like, I'm so thankful people like were just down, you know,
so
and accepting of us.
So after the first record came out, The Last Thing You Forget, which is crazy, because I was like thinking about the name of that record and like how much I was in love with it. And I still love that record. I was actually listening to it like earlier this week, but my Tumblr, and this is going way back, so I used to I like left MySpace, LiveJournal, and then I got a Tumblr, and like literally like my name on my Tumblr, like the header still the Last Thing You Forget. which is sick. Which is crazy. And then once like Tumblr got like a little too crazy, I was like, all right, I need to be a little more legit and get a real website. And even for like the longest time on my actual website, jamerk.com, that was still the header, the last thing you forget. And I literally didn't change it until I had to start branding for the podcast. But that was the only reason why I changed it. But like the name of that record and that just record, like in its entirety, is just so amazing to me. And like the music it's so cool that it still holds up to this day.
That's really funny that was your username. That's cool. That's really cool though. Yeah. Thank you, man. I don't know what to say.
Can you talk about where the album name comes from?
I mean, it's a lyric from what song is that? Introvert, I think, right? Mm-hmm. I think it was probably just like, who knows? But to me, my like interpretation and a little bit of my memory is like, we were like going for like this like heady, like a little bit more like heady, like title, like it reminds me of Do You Know Who You Are, like the Texas Is the Reason shit. Mm-hmm. I think we were probably like trying to like force a little bit of like maturity or like just a little bit more like introspection or something, because at that time we were like, I feel like, starting to like shed our skin a little bit from like being a more local like poppy band. Like there's bands like that, that at the time, like Set Your Goals, that like we're starting to like bridge this like pop punk and hardcore thing, but in a way that was like a little bit more like, I don't want to say obvious, but whatever. They had breakdowns and shit. And we were just like, I think we were trying to like lean a little bit more in towards like, we wanted to be like a rev band. You know what I mean? We wanted to be a little bit more poetic in our approach and in our lyrics. So I don't know. I couldn't tell you. I think Ned wrote those lyrics, so it's probably a question better for him. But from my point of view, it's like, it was more like, yeah, we were just trying to like, yeah, that's just the direction we were trying to go in, like this like headier type of, I don't know, that type of shit.
And can you talk about your relationship with John Slaby?
John Slaby, yeah.
Oh, Slaby, like, excuse me.
That's all good. Some people actually had a conversation with him about that recently too, because Turnover calls him Slaby. And he said, I was like, yo, I asked Slaby, I was like, yo, like, what's up with like, and he's like, yeah, I know they call me that. Like, he's like, I kind of like it. I've always kind of liked when people called me that. I was like, oh, I didn't know, but I think it's Slaby. That's what I call him. But that's like, yeah, that dude is super, super inspiring to me. He's like, he's a great friend, super, super supportive. And he's just like, he's a fucking OG. Like, he's opened my eyes and inspired me in a lot of different ways. So, I don't want to like dry snitch or anything like that, but he was just like into like doing art and stuff like that in our local area, which is like, at the time, whenever, I think I was probably like in high school at this point when I started to like get hip to like the stuff he was doing. And it was just like, shit stands out here because it is like a really small, weird little town. So like anything like a little bit out of the ordinary or a little bit different is like gonna pop. So yeah, the stuff he was doing, the art that he was making, just really like spoke to me at the time, I guess. And he was like involved in like the local skating scene. Like he's in this skate crew called Nesk, who's like has this crazy long history of like local skating where they would put out videos, and he's just like a head that knew cool shit and made cool art, you know. So I didn't know him. He like, I think Alex, Ned and Ben's brother, was like friendly with him, and he was like of that generation, like a handful of years older than I was. So I think I just hit him up one day because I was just like looking at some paintings he made, and I was just like, yo, like your paintings are sick. Like I'm in this band, like we want to do a 7-inch, wherever you want to use your art, blah, blah, blah. So he was just like kind enough to like recognize the passion maybe. And he just was like, yeah, let's, I think at first he like said no or something, but then he like kind of came back around, and yeah, we started working with him. And it was just like the way he approaches art and the way he thinks about art and his experience, like the way he archives his childhood and his like his exploits in our area is like this really like touching, crazy thing to me. He's like really in tune artistically with like the nooks and crannies of where we're from and this like exploratory, I don't know. I feel like a little bit on the spot because I want to say like all the right things to like lift him up because he's such an inspiration, but it just like hit me. It struck me, like his stuff just struck me and still strikes me in a way that was just like speaks to my childhood experience in a way. And I think that really like matches well with Title Fight's music, especially like at that time too, like this like coming of age, like finding yourself and identifying through like these weird nooks and crannies and shortcuts in your town, like that type of thing. It was like, it just made a lot of sense for what we were trying to say. What we were trying to say musically, I think it just was represented similarly with what he was doing visually. So like, he was just like down, and then we just like became friends. And now he's just like, yeah, to this day, like a huge inspiration. And he did all the Title Fight artwork. Like every album we put out after The Last Thing You Forget, he did all the artwork for. So it was like such a cool union for me. Like, I feel super proud of that. And yeah, shout out Slaby.
Yeah, I remember seeing the artwork and it always looked interesting to me, and I was just like always curious about like, you know, what the significance were to like all the little things in the artwork. So and figuring out that he went on to work with you guys for every album, I thought that was cool that you guys kept that relationship and were able to grow with him through the rest of the music.
Yeah, man, he like definitely sharpened are the taste level as far as art goes for like everyone in Wilkes-Barre, I'd say. He's a super influential guy.
So The Last Thing You Forget drops, you guys were starting to grow as a band, becoming like a national act. Was there a significant moment for you where you just kind of like stopped and were like, holy shit, like we're an actual like full-time band doing like stuff that I thought about when I was a kid?
Yeah, I think I felt that feeling like a lot over the years, but probably like the time when it came to a crazy head was I guess it was after, once The Last Thing You Forget was out in 2009, I was going to school in Philly, and everybody else in Title, like I'm the oldest one in Title Fight by like a year pretty much, so everyone else was still in high school. So I went to, sorry, what's up? Are you there?
Oh, yeah. Are you
right? Yeah, I'm good. Sorry, my bad. I just thought it cut off for a second.
Oh, no, it's all good. Yeah, I thought you were talking to somebody in the room with you. It's all good.
No. I'm just talking into my computer by myself. I can't remember the exact timeline. I might have like a little bit. My memory sucks, honestly. But in 2009, I know that for sure. I was going to school. Oh, no. So I was in school already for like a year or something, and then everyone, Ned, Ben, and Jamie graduated high school, and Ned and Ben moved to Philly as well, or close to Philly at least. Like I was living with Ben actually in Fishtown in Philly, and he was going to Temple, I was going to the art school there, and Ned was at another college. I think Jamie was just at home chilling, and it was around that time like we started to get hit up by like labels, like kind of like I think like Epitaph and like some major labels and shit were like sniffing around, and then like we got like a tour offer from Newfound Glory, which was like at the time was like insane, like we couldn't believe that, we're like what the fuck. And then like shortly after that it was like we got another tour offer to like go to the UK and Europe, and then like all this kind of attention started to like funnel at once. And I just stopped, like, I just was, like, stopped caring about school. I was just like, yo, like, fuck this. Like, let's, you know what I mean? Like, let's try this. Like, we've been doing this for how long? Like, this is what we want. And, like, it seems like the opportunity is finally presenting itself. So it was around that time, like, I remember it was probably, like, a good, like, month or so that I was in school, that I was just like kind of like, it was early in the semester too. I was just like, I just accepted. I was like, yo, like this is too exciting. And like, I just know that it's gonna like, I know we're just going to drop out and start and do this tour and like go for it, you know? So I think it was around that time where that was like a huge turning point in my life, because I was just like trying to like pursue my college degree. Like I was trying to get a BFA, and like, I don't know, I didn't, at the time I was like, I was into it, but like not really, like just kind of going through the motions, like waiting to see like if anything with Title Fight would happen, because that's like where my whole like heart was, you know? So it's just crazy, like it just, the opportunity just happened. It was like winning the lottery or something. That's how I felt. It was just like, fuck, like we can go on tour, like yeah, like I'll drop everything, like I'll go into debt, like I don't give a fuck, like this is what I want, you know? So I think it was that around that time, like when we accepted that tour with Newfound Glory, and like whatever, like these labels were like, we were talking to like taking meetings or whatever the fuck, like these types of things, like I think it was around that time when I felt the most like insane, you know?
And speaking of bigger labels, I feel like that's always like a scary thing for a band on the come up, because a lot of times that could be make or break. You could get locked into like a weird contract and that could like ruin the band, or there's always like this weird thing where bands are good, but then they get signed to a bigger label and somehow in some weird way the band just falls apart, whether it be through the sound or the band just actually breaking up. Did you guys have that in mind when you were talking to these bigger labels? Were you even actually taking them serious, or were you guys just interested in hearing what they had to say? Were there any real aspirations to sign to a bigger label like that?
I mean, we ended up signing to like a somewhat bigger like indie label, Side One, but we talked to like major labels and stuff, and yeah, we just like, we took the meetings because it was mostly because it was funny, you know, just to be like, all right, like what's the, like whatever, going to some CEO's office in New York and LA or whatever, like, and we just like, we just saw through the bullshit, I think, like in those like types of meetings, just like kind of like, I don't know, we're just ourselves, and like I think we could just tell, like, all right, this isn't really, like this is cool, this is a good story, but like these late major label trying to sign you for like 8 records or some shit, like fuck that, you know what I mean? Like we wanted to have autonomy. Like I think we were young enough to know that like we wanted autonomy, and we wanted to like do shit the way we wanted to do it. And I think we started working with like a manager at that time who were just like, was just down with us, like down to fight for what we wanted a little bit in a way at the time, I guess. So we're just like, yeah, like this is what we want. Like we just want a tour. Like we're not really sweating. Like we're not trying to be like the Foo Fighters. You know what I mean? Like I think that's what the major labels wanted, but we're just like, we had no idea like what was gonna come next. We just wanted the opportunity to like make more music, and then slowly just like follow, like trace that and see where it goes. You know, there's no like grand plan to like become some giant band or whatever. We just like, I think we were pretty like sensible with just like being realistic. Like, all right, this is what's in front of us. What's like the logical next step? You know what I mean?
Yeah, and I feel like with every record that you guys put out, there was just like a giant leap in your guys's like popularity and like the types of shows and tours that you would be on, which was, it was cool, because I was like hell yeah, like a band that I like is actually taking these like steps and actually has growth and not just kind of like, you know, staying like stagnant. So it was always cool to see. Was that the same thing like from your point of view,
like that we had growth every time we would sign to a new label? Is what it, sorry, what's, I don't understand that question really.
Oh no, I'm so sorry. So with each release that you guys had, if from like a fan looking at your guys' career, it just seemed that like your guys' popularity and growth was just so big with each new release. So like, is that how it felt for you like in real time?
Not really, to be honest, because it was like the steps happened so incrementally for us because we're so invested in it. Like Title Fight has been a band since 2003, yo. Like, mm-hmm. And I joined in 2005. So I don't know. Not that like we ever expected to get to become like a big band or have big shows or whatever, but I think when you see the progress firsthand, it's just like little by little. And the next thing you know, it's like, oh fuck. Like, all right, this is crazy. Like we can do a tour and like invite whoever we want to come on it, and like we can make a couple bucks like for the first time ever. Like those moments, yeah, it felt it felt big, but like, I don't know, every day you're like emailing. And as far, I mean, at least for us, like we were super involved with like every single thing. Like we had a manager, but I don't think we ever needed one. You know what I mean? Like Ben was always super on top of that shit. Like everyone kind of played their role and like was super invested. So it was like more than a full-time job, I think. So to see the progress, like I don't think it hit us the same way it hit someone like you. It was more like incremental and like felt more gradual, but for sure I like recognize and appreciate the growth, you know, but it just didn't seem like this like stark thing. It kind of like just felt, I don't know, it felt kind of logical.
So one big moment for me, I grew up in the Palm Springs area, and you guys got announced that you were playing on Coachella Fest, and I thought that was just the most insane and cool thing ever. Do you remember what that was like for you?
Yeah, like I remember we got asked to do it. I think there was like some deliberation amongst the four of us, like whether or not like we should do it, mm-hmm. because there's always kind of that conversation with anything. But I was hyped, dude. Like it was just, I don't know. I always kind of like appreciate like any opportunity to like get out of my comfort zone and like expand my mind a little bit more beyond like what I'm used to, you know? So I was super excited for that. And like, at the very least, like I think around that time we had done like some bigger festivals, and like I liked playing them. Like I liked playing the set was cool, but like just to be at the festival and to like be able to go wherever you need to go and like watch bands that normally I wouldn't be able to get to see like playing, you know, that was like super exciting to me. So not to say that I didn't enjoy like touring with hardcore and punk bands, like I love that, but it's also like to have that experience where like I could go watch like, I don't know, Outkast or whatever, whoever, I can't remember who else played that the year Coachella we did, but that type of shit where it's just like, we're here, like I didn't have to pay to be here. And like, yeah, it's just like weird fairy tale, like backstage where it's like celebrities, and like I love that shit. Like it's funny to me, it's like it's exciting. And at the end of the day, like we played a show and like kids were there to see us, and that's always an amazing thing. So it was like, yeah, I felt like a very fun, positive thing to do. I thought, I can't speak for the rest of it. I'm sure like if you ask some of the other guys, like they would probably tell you like it was whack or something, but I personally fucked with it
for sure. Yeah, I go to Coachella from time to time. If there's like a band that I really want to see, I'll make a real effort to make it out to the fest, because it's a, you know, it's really expensive, and you know, to get time off of work, it's just like it's a whole thing that you have to like, you know, turn into if you want to just go to this fest. And it's like one of the biggest fests in the world. So I think it's really cool that you guys are able to say that you played Coachella Fest.
Yeah, I feel very fortunate, and it's definitely up my respect from like my family that doesn't know or understand anything about what I do or am trying to do. So okay. Yeah, I would do it again for sure.
So fast forward to 2015, you guys put out your latest record, Hyperview. And I remember when that record came out, obviously there was a shift in your guys' sound. And I know in my circle of friends, it got mixed reviews. And for me, being a fan of Title Fight, I was always a fan of the progression in the music with each record. So I was open-minded going into the record, and I listened to it, and I think it took a little time for me to grow and to be able to bond with it, but I enjoy that record to this day. I still enjoy it, and I hate when people try to knock it. It's just like, is just really frustrating to me, because I'm just like, okay, like this band, Title Fight, they're awesome, everybody knows that, but you can't expect them to put out the same record again and again, because at some point it's going to get stale, and then you're just going to get turned off. So I always get lost at the fact that people are so close-minded when it comes to music.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, that's That's understandable. It was definitely like, I feel like the biggest departure we've had as a band. So it makes sense that people, not everybody was into it. It doesn't really bother me that much. I respect, you know, there's plenty of music that I don't fuck with. So I can't have my feelings hurt when that happens to something that I've been a part of, you know. But I don't know, like, I don't think we ever really like felt like it was like a failure or anything. I think if anything, like the shows, maybe like people didn't really like know how they wanted to like respond to it, because they're so used to just like going off for everything that was a little bit more high energy, you know. That was like the only real like thing I ever like noticed, was like when we played those songs live, people would just kind of like chill out for a second, you know. But I don't know, I like that like range and being able to like show that there's more than just one dimension, you know.
Yeah, because it shows that you guys are actually talented musicians and don't have to go to the same well every time to try to please the fans. I appreciate that you guys were brave enough to, you know, take that step in the progression and put out that record instead of just playing it safe and putting out something that sounded like the older stuff.
Yeah. Do you think it sounds weird now though, or like in 2015 it sounded weird?
Okay. If I'm gonna be honest, the way that I try to explain it to people who try to give that record flack, I'm a fan of a band called Brand New, and if you look at their discography, they did the same thing with every new release. Their sound just progressed, and if you look at their first record to the latest record, they sound nothing alike. And to me, that's awesome. I think it's cool to hear your guys's expression through the music, because if you guys put out a record like Shed or Floral Green, like the next like four records, and it sounded just like that, people like me, I'd get bored. I'd be like, okay, like, is this all they have? It can't be, because like those records are good. They have to be more talented and be able to put out different kinds of music, if that makes sense.
Definitely. And like, I feel like people just associate this weird like blanket like standard that applies to every band throughout history or something, that's like, I don't know. People don't realize, like, if we like went into the studio like a month later to record any of our records, like it would be a different record, you know. And not to say that like they're not important. Like, we put 100% effort into everything we did always, but not that it was easy to make music, but it's just like however we're feeling is just like what we're gonna say, you know. And like, to me, that's the most important thing. Is like, it's just like, yeah, like this is our medium. This is how we express ourselves, and the way we feel and the way we think changes regularly. So it's just like, I don't know, like we were just adding to that mass that we've been building, you know. Like, it was like, it's just how we were feeling, you know. And I want to hear how people feel. Like, I don't want people to be so concerned with like convention and like, I don't know, starting a band because you like want to go on tour. Like, I think that's kind of whack, you know. Like, to play a show, yeah, but like, I don't know, you should be invested in like trying to commune with like your soul through this medium of music, you know. And like, that's the important thing, is like, I want to listen to, like, if I look at art or listen to music, like, I want to feel like that person was tapped into themselves and not doing something or making art for any reason other than like fulfilling their own desire, you know. Because that, I feel like that's usually where the best shit is. But it's like, there's plenty of bands that like just like run off with the swag and just do everything we did that was like that hit, and then they like perfect it and whatever. Like, it's fucking corny, you know what I mean? Like, I want to hear what someone has to say. Like, who are you? You know, what are you about? So I don't really feel like any type of way about anything I've ever done, like artistically or musically, because it's always been like 100% like, yo, like, this is just us. Like, it's just like having a conversation with somebody, you know. That's just the way we had the conversation. It's just like, at that time, it sounded like that. It felt like that. Like, it was just real.
And I appreciate that. I feel that's the, like the way you described it, that's how you should approach it, is just kind of go about it and be real. And I know I'm, you know, putting out music, doing a band, or doing anything that's going to be in the public eye, obviously there's like, you know, weird stigmas that come along with it. Obviously you're going to be judged, and you have to accept that not everybody's going to enjoy what you do. So you have to appreciate the people that actually care about what you're doing, and let that be your motivator. Because obviously, like me, I do this podcast, or I try to do this podcast every week, and I sit here and I talk to people like you, and I don't put on like an act, or I don't put on like a special voice. Like the way we're talking right now is obviously, you know, because like we've hung out, but this is how I normally am. I feel like if I was going to do this podcast and put it out there for the masses to listen to, I have to do it as myself. Whether they like it or hate it, I'm just going to put it out there. And if people listen, that's awesome. And if people don't, like, it's cool. I get it. Cause like, you know, there's tons of podcasts and stuff that like, I just am not into, like I've tried, but it's just not for me. And that's fine too, because I just at an early age, I kind of realized like, okay, not everybody's going to like me, and I'm okay with that. I'm just going to be myself, and I'm not going to sacrifice the things that I'm into or my personality just to try to please people, because that's just going to drive me insane.
Yeah. Respect, man. I mean, I could see that like in just listening to your interviews too. I think that's why I'm like so endeared to you, is like for that reason. It was like, I could tell you're just like yourself, you know, like you don't care if you come off as awkward or like nerdy or overbearing, whatever. Like you're just like having a conversation with someone that you respect, and like you're giving yourself to that person, and I think that's commendable. Like, not, you know, some people just aren't in touch with that, and for better or for worse, you know. But I can recognize that you're just tapped into who you are, and that's why I think I like listening to your podcast, to be honest, because I feel that I identify with that, like whether or not I share the same like points of view as you, like I can sense that you're just like being yourself, and you know what I mean? You love Disney and this shit. It's like, it's cool. Like it feels like intimate in that way. Whereas like, if it was like, you're trying to be this like master podcast guy that is like got some perfect formula figured out, and like you're like protecting your identity or something, it's like, it's corny. Yeah. I think, yeah, you just got to be yourself. I think that's like, it sounds so simple, but our society kind of tells you to do everything but just be yourself and be in tune with who you are, how you feel, where you come from, you know, what you're trying to do, what you're trying to say. So
yeah, it's a weird battle with like society these days, all like for social media, because there's so many people who are focused on getting the likes and like all the pop tags and just trying to impress your followers, which is so strange to me, because like I was so into like Instagram and Twitter, and just over the years I just kind of realized like how gross like a lot of people are, like just fronting with like their lifestyle, not actually portraying who they really are, and it just kind of turned me off. So yeah, I still have social media, but I'm not as present as I used to be, because I used to be tweeting like multiple times a day, and like these days it's like you're lucky to see like, you know, maybe one or two from me per day outside of promoting the podcast.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a great tool, but yeah, some people just get consumed, and I mean, some people use it the right way, I think, but yeah, a lot, you're just fighting with people that are like taking up that space, you know, to like just be a poser. I don't know how else to say it, but just like people that aren't in touch with themselves and what they want to say and what they want to do, and are like faking the funk just to like get likes or to say the right thing or to appease this person or that person, is like, it's fucking whack.
Okay, so fast forward, was it, now I'm drawing a blank, was it 2018, Title Fight played a show in Amityville, New York?
Yeah, was it? I can't remember what year it was. Was it 2018? You probably know better than I do.
I'm gonna look
it up. But that sounds kind of right.
Yeah, I have to look it up. Yes, it was 2018. It was January 26, 2018. You guys played a benefit show.
Mm-hmm. For our friend Aaron Warman, who was like toured with us for Mad Long. He's our tour manager. He's a great friend.
So
his mom passed away. It was a really sad situation, but it felt good to come together and, you know, do something positive for him and his family.
I thought that was really awesome of you guys to be able to do that for them. After the set ended, did you guys know that that was going to be the last show that was going to be, or that you guys were going to have played for a long time, or over time, did you guys just not get any offers to do anything?
I don't think I knew, I don't know. It's hard to talk about this angle of it because it's something that I fully don't really understand. So I think, it was definitely a conscious decision to do less, because up until that point, I think maybe a year or two before that, we had been coming off the back of touring for 7 or 8 years straight and just committing almost every second of our days to doing the band, writing, recording, touring, all this stuff. So it was kind of, I think that show kind of came at the early part of us wanting to maybe just press pause for a second. And I had gone back to school at that time, same with Ned, and then Jamie kind of shortly followed, maybe a year or so after that. So I think those types of things just kind of became the priority of all each of our lives, as we're just wanted to take a break, you know. And to this day, Title Fight has always felt this force or this phenomenon that I've never really fully been able to understand, you know. And in the same still stands for the situation now, which it almost feels cursed or something in a way, where I don't really quite understand what's going on, but just letting it breathe and let everybody just live their lives and maybe come back or reassess it at some point when the stars align, or maybe that never happens. I'm not really quite sure, to be honest.
So if you can confirm, I know just through listening to interviews, there was talks of you guys had gone together to write some new stuff. Was that was that true? You guys ever in the works of working on the next record?
Oh, where'd you see that?
Oh, it was just an interview. I don't remember exactly the quote, so I don't want to say it and butcher it, but it was from 2017. That's all I remember.
Word. There's definitely when we recorded Hyperview, there was we scrapped basically more than half of the album to shift towards a different vibe. Mm-hmm. So there's songs that haven't been finished, and there's always ideas, but I can't really quite remember writing much more after Hyperview. That could be true, but I don't really recall that, to be honest. But yeah, there's no plans at the moment. So
yeah,
I mean, every song I've ever on my hard drive, or I've ever messed around with, I guess has the potential. Mm-hmm. And I think probably the same for everyone else, maybe, but I don't know. It's right. Yeah, I don't know.
Well, it definitely is strange, because I feel I've been around for so long, and there's a whole new crop of kids that never got the chance to see you guys. And over the years of you guys being absent, there has been this mystique that has been built up, so many memes, which is so crazy to see. Every now and then, I'm not even looking for these things, and they just pop in my feed from people that I don't even follow, saying that they miss Title Fight or where is Title Fight.
So yeah, I like the SpongeBob ones. You see those?
Yeah, no, yeah, I've definitely seen some of those. So it definitely is crazy how that's happened over the years. But for me, I do cherish those times that I was able to see you guys live. I still enjoy the records to this day, and I would love it if you guys came back and did stuff. That'd be cool. But if you didn't, I'm sure there has to be a good reason behind it. And I would, you know, gladly be fine with that option too. You guys never coming back. I would be a little sad, but I get it. You know, things happen, you know, people's lives, you know, alter course and that's that. So, whatever happens in the future, you know, I just have to accept it and be okay with it.
Yeah, dude, I feel like I'm in the same boat as you, to be honest. Like, I feel like title fight is for everyone in a way, you know. I feel like this like shared experience with like everybody that's ever had anything to do with it. So yeah, I revere it in a similar way. And I, like I said, like it feels like almost like a curse or something that I don't really like quite get, but it's not really like tripping me out because I'm like been psyched to like become a little bit more in touch with myself as like an individual and working towards things that I've always wanted to work towards, like that kind of, that title fight kind of got in the way of, you know? So we're just, you know, it's just life, yo. It's like, I don't know, but I don't know who, I don't feel this like pressure to like really like acknowledge it or like give a definitive answer about anything because I don't know, like, I think if it's something will happen, then it'll happen. You know what I mean? But if not, then something else good will happen. You know what I mean? Like it's, I don't know. It's hard to put into words how I feel about it, but yeah, it's, I feel you. I see, I hear you and I feel you. I feel similarly.
Okay. All right. So, moving on from Top Fight, as much as like I love Top Fight, I could talk about Top Fight all day. But
yeah, me too.
But
it's like this crazy, crazy special thing in my life. So I'm like super. I'm happy to talk about it, and I'm glad I got to like go down memory lane a little bit because it's like, yeah, it still to this day like informs a lot of how I look at the world and stuff. So you don't gotta feel bad about talking about Title Fight for a while because I enjoy it as well.
Okay, all right, because I just want to seem like I'm pestering you about it, but
no.
Going back to Santa Fury 2009, I remember leading up to that, I was telling all my friends, I'm like, yo, check out this band, they're called Bad Seed. Like, all I want to do is see that band at Santa Fury, my summer is going to be made. And some of my friends were there in attendance, so they were able to enjoy that set as well. I was just so curious, like, where did the idea spawn for Bad Seed? And you guys had a theme. Obviously, the name refers to Chucky, like, you know, Child's Play. Like, where did that? And I was just curious, so like, where did the band start, and like, where did that theming come in? Like, who had the idea for that?
So those are two different questions, I think. Bad Seed was born from so that I think I mentioned him earlier. Saba, he played in the Gnarlies later on. It was like our hardcore band of little kids. It was just like he's like, just I don't know. He's just like a really super super close friend. Always kind of in the same orbit as Title Fight and the Gnarlies and that shit. So when the Gnarlies like ended, yeah, he just hit me up. He's like, yo, like, I liked how you sang on the Gnarlies. Like, I want to, like, play guitar, like, in a new band, whatever. And he's, like, super talented. Like, to this day, like, he's been sitting on music that's, like, he needs to fucking finish it because it's, we need more of that in Wilkes-Barre. But he just hit me up and he's just like, yeah, like, I want to do a band with you, whatever, like, more hardcore, like, metallic type of shit. And I was just like, yeah, let's do it. So that's how it started. I think we just knew we like had chemistry. So we started jamming wherever, and he started writing songs. And then originally Ben from Tiger's Jaw played drums, and Wicca Phase played bass, which is really funny to me. And we practiced like that for a little, I think we recorded the first demo with those guys. And then something funny happened where Ben and Adam got kicked out, but like for like a really like funny and like non like a passive kind of reason. I can't remember really what the deal was. But then we brought in Rifkin on drums and some other friend. I think Jamie, or I can't remember who started playing bass first, but yeah, just like it just became, it kind of morphed into like a little bit more of like a serious thing after a year or two. But it was just kind of born from like just being friends with these guys and like, yeah, just wanting to make a new project, something like a little bit more heavier and like hard, like explicitly hardcore, you know? And I think the Chucky stuff came from Rifkin, actually. Shout out Rifkin. He put me onto like a ton of, I remember he burned me like 100+ CDs of like hardcore bands when I was real young, like just starting to find my bearings of like what I liked about hardcore. And he's like a little bit older guy that like looked out for me. He's a super good drummer. But I think he was either him or Hoodrack, who's like another like Wilkes-Barre OG, came up with the idea to use Chucky as like the mascot, kind of, because the name was Bad Seed, obviously. It just kind of made sense and was like, it just worked. But it was also kind of like a little bit of like a troll kind of thing, kind of just like a funny little mascot, you know. Yeah, so that's where that shit came from.
And doing the band, at any point did you have any idea at how popular you guys are going to be? Because I feel obviously it was always described as a Members of Title Fight, but the music was awesome. I feel like even if it wasn't Members of Title Fight, like Bad Seed could stand alone. The music was great. I loved everything you guys put out. Did you have any idea that you guys would get that kind of reception when you're doing the band?
Thank you. No, I mean, I don't think I've ever thought about like how people are going to react to stuff, to be honest. Like, I think you just like know that the opportunity to like make something exists, the opportunity to play a show exists. So if you can just like reach that goal, maybe, you know, maybe you can put out a record or whatever. But like, we just wanted to like put it down, you know what I mean? We just wanted to, I don't know. Saba and I shared like a love of like Pantera and Madball and Biohazard and this shit. So we're just like, that's what we were focused on. We're just like, let's do something sick. Like, yeah, we want to play shows under this moniker. And like, you know what I mean? It was just about that. It was just about like friendship and creating something, I think. I don't think we really, and even like Bad Seed, we played Sound of Fury. Like, that was so sick. I remember that show was like crazy. Like, people were going nuts. And like, there were some little moments where we played like a festival or like a bigger show and like things were sick. But like, I definitely didn't feel like a big band, especially at that time. Like, we did little runs and like shows, little weekends, whatever, and like it wasn't big. Like, even we play in Wilkes-Barre and like it was whatever, you know. Like, it never really, I feel like it's been like, what, like 10 years or something, we're like a decade removed from that. And I think the lore of it is like also like charged into the appeal of it nowadays, where it's like people from across the world have had the time to like discover it and digest it. But like at the time, it never really felt like a bit necessarily big band. Like, I don't know, like if Title Fight didn't play Santa Fury that year, like I doubt Bad Seed would have even been able to like play, you know what I mean? We like Title Fight kind of enabled Bad Seed to like do cool things like that. But during the time, it was just like, it wasn't really like, we weren't really that like popping, you know what I mean?
One thing I was always curious about, I've seen a ton of different Bad Seed shirts. I own a Bad Seed shirt. But I was curious, did you guys ever do any Chucky designs?
Yeah, I never really. It's funny because I'm like so into art and design. But I remember at the time, like I just relegated everything to Rifkin and Hoodrack. Hoodrack was like our de facto art guy. So I can't like, honestly, I thought a lot of the Bad Seed merch was super ugly. But some of it was really good. One of them being the Chucky design. I think it was on a hoodie or something, maybe like a zip up, okay, with like the hoodie, like a Chucky on the pocket print. And we did like, I also have a bandana that I was wearing recently for, okay, as a replace of a face mask that was like, has a Chucky on it. And I think Hoodrack did that one.
Okay.
Interesting. Yeah. My favorite song.
Those designs are good. Anything Hoodrack did was sick looking.
I like the, it was the, I think it was the final show t-shirt, the one with like the, like a jester or like a joker on it. Do you know
what? Is it like red and blue and shit?
Yeah.
That, I straight up found that exact design on a Dave Matthews Band shirt when I was thrifting one time. So someone, whoever made that, just like stole it from a Dave Matthews Band shirt.
Okay. Oh, so they might have been a Dave Matthews Band fan.
Yeah, or it's just like clip art or something.
Okay, that's awesome. That's so funny. I would have never
known. I think that should probably make it more valuable, hopefully.
Okay. My my favorite Bad Seed song has to be Harsh Reality.
Yeah, that's a cool one. I like the lyrics of that one.
Yeah. Yeah, that one always like stood out to me. So and the shirt that I have has lyrics on it. It's the one with the rats. I don't know if you remember that
design. Yeah. That was an okay design.
Yeah. Okay. Well, yeah, I love Bad Seed. I'm happy that I was able to catch him. You know what's crazy is you guys, you know, went away and TUI, they were on hiatus and they came back and they played a show in LA and they covered Bad Seed, which I thought was so random. I was like, okay, this is crazy, but this is cool. I don't know if you ever heard about that.
Yeah, I've seen that. I think Justice has a Bad Seed tattoo, which is really funny to me. But they're like Trapped Under Ice was like their demo, I think, was like probably like 95% inspiration for Bad Seed. Like, to be honest, like I remember hearing that when I was at like my first year of college or something, just being like, yo, like this is so sick. It's super heavy, it's hard, but these dudes are just like from Baltimore, like they're way more jacked than me, but I identified with like them, like just kind of being like having like more like emo kind of lyrics in a way, and like singing about like how they felt, but it was like paired with like this super ass beater sound, you know. And like, yeah, gotta give up to Trapped Under Ice. We're like one of the big, like most influential hardcore bands ever, probably.
Yeah, I think
they're a super fucking amazing band.
Yes, I love them. You know, when they came out to Sound and Fury for the first time, that shit was crazy. And then just seeing them grow as a band was just so sick. One of like the biggest and best bands in hardcore.
Yeah, that was a vibe. The stretch of years that they were like going in was like really cool to be a part of that, to bear witness.
Yeah. Okay. So moving on from Bad Seed. So Title Fight, Bad Seed is kind of put on pause. At that point in your life, are you still trying to do music, or did you want to focus more on your art? Like, what direction were you heading in at that point?
Yeah. So, like, I remember like being on tour in Europe with Title Fight and having a feeling like, all right, like it doesn't seem like much is gonna be going on after this tour. So, I applied to get back into school because I had dropped out of college. Like I said, in 2009, and like along with that, like I like just like was really reckless about like student loans and debt and all that type of shit. So I had like had committed like a decent amount of time to like going to school and paying for it out of pocket. So I remember thinking like, all right, maybe I should like go back to school and like wrap up like a degree or something. You know what I mean? Because it just seemed like the opportunity was there the first time in like 7 or 8 years. So I was just like, all right, let's just try to like at least have something to show for this tens of thousands of dollars that I've like dug myself into a hole of. So I originally was in school for like a fine art degree, and I wasn't really sure of like what that was gonna become at the time. But like by the time I applied to go back to school, I was like more interested in fashion design. So that's like what I got accepted into a school, like into a fashion design program. And then I end up doing that like for the next year and a half or whatever. And then I got a degree. So that was like the next step for me.
And I know that you designed stuff. I actually bought the shirt that you designed for Supreme like more recently. And I thought that was really cool. Can you talk about like how you actually got to that point in your career? Because I was surprised. I was just, you know, going through my Instagram story
And then you had posted like the week of that your shirt was dropping. I was like, holy shit, like I didn't even know this was happening. So I was like, I had to, you know, try to cop that.
Yeah. That was really cool, like cool moment for me. And I like to thank a cool moment for like everyone that, I don't know, like I don't want to say all punk and hardcore, but like that's how I took it, because I think it was like sort of informed by the art that I was making, but also that I was like attached to this like subculture that was this vibrant thing that has influence and whatever. I mean, I don't know for sure, but that's kind of my interpretation. So I felt like I was really proud of that. But how it happened was like when I was in school, actually, I met a friend. His name's Tori, and at the time he worked at he worked in like fashion industry, and he was like a hardcore kid. I met him at a show at like 538. He was like a hardcore dude. He was into Title Fight and Bad Seed and stuff. He's a little bit older than me, but he's just like a cool dude, and he just like, I don't know, for whatever reason, just like showed me love, and like he helped get me an internship at a job that he used to have like when I was going to school. When I was living in New York and going to school, he got me an internship at Marc Jacobs, which is like it was a pretty sick internship to have. So after that, I just kind of like kept in touch with him, and he like made some Title Fight designs and whatever, just kind of formed a friendship. And then, after a while, like he started working at Supreme, and then we just kept in touch, and he hit me up, and it kind of just happened from there. I can't really, like, I don't know if I should like divulge too much about it, because I had to fucking sign all this like contracts and stuff, but
for sure. No,
it was a hardcore kid that made it happen for me. So I'm super thankful and owe that to him for sure. 100%.
That's super sick. I literally had no idea. And it's pretty crazy too, because you think about Supreme, skateboard brand. Hopefully people know that, and how involved like a lot of people in hardcore are with that brand. I think it was cool that you were able to do a design for them and it get support and, selling out, which is cool.
Yeah, it was sick, man.
So going,
I was psyched.
So going forward, I read that digital zine you did with the dude from Candy. I'm drawing a blank on his name right now. And
oh yeah, Cheddar. Is it Michael Quick, the dude from Candy? Yeah.
And you mentioned it, I'm in there because I read it. You mentioned that you were trying to get away from doing like graphic designs, like, you know, for t-shirts and stuff. Can you talk about why you feel that way and like what direction you want to take your art in going forward?
Yeah, it's funny that interview, like, it came out really sick. I was psyched on it, but after I got off the phone with him, I was like tripping. I was like, yo, I think I just like spazzed out for like way too long on this dude, and he's gonna like not know how to like condense what I said or anything. And I think I told you, I was like, it made me want to actually do an interview with you, because we've been talking about it for a while, and I was just like, I want to kind of like paint the picture a little bit more slowly, and like, because it's like, it's just hard to talk about that type of stuff without jumping around, like having to talk about Title Fight or what going to, like, thinking about art or whatever, you know, is all these, like, I just felt really unorganized, and, like, I did a really, like, in general, I do a really bad job at representing myself. But, yeah, that kind of, like, prompted me to, like, be like, all right, it came out sick, but, like, let's try to maybe build upon that a little bit more. So, yeah, so I don't think I'm, like, I don't want to, like, stop doing designs altogether. Like, I'm super fortunate to have that opportunity. And, like, I love being able to, like, do a design for a friend's band or, like, a band from Wilkes-Barre. Like, that type of shit is, like, really cool to me. But I just feel, like, kind of burnt out on doing it lately, where my process, I think, I just, like, it takes me so long to make those things. And I don't know. I've been, like, thinking about fine art a little bit more, like maybe making paintings and drawings and photography and video and music, and those types of channels are just like a little bit more liberating and freeing right now. And I just kind of like prefer to, if I'm gonna commit like a whole week to doing something, I would kind of at this point prefer to reserve that energy for like myself, like things that I'm really psyched on. Not that I'm not psyched on a t-shirt, but just like, I just wish I was like a better technician or better draftsman so I can like pump shit out faster. But like, it just like, it's a really like intense, laborious process for me. So I think I was kind of just speaking to that a little bit, where it's just like, I kind of just want to take a break and like make paintings, you know what I mean? Just let myself like continue to work and continue to try to understand myself, but without like this weird like middle man that exists when you're trying to do something like commission based work. It's always like, it's just a little bit, it's a little bit different of like an energy, and then you kind of have to like talk about money and you have to talk about what they want, and then like it just kind of compromises a lot of like how I like to do things or how I'm even able to do things. It's like making a drawing is like, I have like a background in making art and drawing and stuff, but like it's like a weird background, and I can't just like, if someone asks me to draw like a zombie or like a fucking, I don't know, anything, like I can't just like, I'm not like that good to just like whip it up. Like my process is like much different, where like I kind of like am exploring like shapes and carve, like reverse engineering something based off of like an abstract mark I made, and like, oh, this looks like a fucking dragon, like let me try to figure that out, you know? So it's like I'm trying to like find a way to just be a little bit more personally fulfilled with making art, because I'm like really into it. But it's just the commission based stuff is just like something that just feels a little bit like consuming too much of my energy and too much of my time right now. And it's like, I'm super fortunate to be doing it, but it's like 5% of like what I want to say or what I want to do as an artist. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I definitely get that. I think it's impressive that you're able to, you know, actually do these designs for people, because I look at some of the stuff that you've done and I was like, man, like are they giving you direction on what they want, or are they giving you like free rein?
Sometimes people would be like, yeah, I like this, I like this. Or sometimes it's like I have free rein. And like sometimes having some input is like good, and sometimes it's like it makes me want to fucking never do it again, you know what I mean? It just depends on like it depends on everything.
Okay, yeah. So I think back to my buddy Alvin. He is like an amazing tattoo artist. He owns a shop in Fullerton, shout out Roseland Tattoo. He hates doing script, but he won't tell me that, because like every time I've ever gotten tattooed by him, I'm always like, hey, like let's throw some script on there, and he's like, all right, cool, like let's see if I can work it in. But because I literally give him free rein, I'm like, hey, this is like, I'll give him like what my general idea is, but then I'll just let him do whatever. Like I try not to have any like weird inputs, because like I'm not an artist. I like to let the artist be the artist. And I always think it's funny that he kind of always like kind of gets out of doing the script portion of the tattoos. He's always like, hey, like let's do it next time. I'm like, all right, cool. And then next time it's like, let's do it next time. And then I kind of like realize like, oh, he doesn't like doing script. He hates it. But I think it's funny. But yeah, I think it's like, you know, pretty important to like kind of let the artist be free, because for me, I said like I'm not an artist, so like I don't feel like it's right for me to try to tell them like what to do. Like that's why I just like to give like a general idea, and like 9 times out of 10 it's like way better than anything I could ever come up with.
For sure. I mean, I don't say these things to like flex that like I have a superior art mind than the person that's like hitting me up. It's just, I think for me, and maybe your friend too, like maybe it's just comes down to like the process, and we're just like, I don't feel completely confident all the time to deliver what this person expects when there's like, when it's predicated by like X, Y, and Z. Like sometimes like just like letting go of expectation is like, for me personally, is the thing that is going to lead me to like make something that's like the sickest thing that I can possibly make, you know what I mean? Like otherwise it's like a barrier. There's this weird barrier where it's like, all right, now I gotta like deal with like script, right? Now I need to implement this thing that they have like something really specific in their mind that they're seeing, and like no matter what I do, it's not going to be that, you know? So yeah, it's probably, for me, it's more of just like, If my ability allowed me to just like easily make these things real, then it wouldn't be a problem. But it's just like, I don't know. For me, it's just like, that's just how it is.
Are you familiar with the artist David Cho?
Is that the dude that did the Facebook mural and got stock in the company like when they were small?
Yes.
Yeah, that's like the most I know about that dude. I think he had a TV show maybe like 5 or 10 years ago. I checked it out, but I couldn't tell you anything about that dude beyond that. I'm not really that familiar. So what's good with him?
So I'm not like, you know, super into like the art world. I don't really know like what's going on or like what's like, you know, the most popular stuff going on. But like I've always been drawn to him. I actually found out about him through like his old like YouTube show. So he had like an old YouTube show called Thumbs Up, and him and his best friend, they would or it was his cousin. Yeah, I think it was his cousin if I remember correctly.
They'd hitchhike?
Yeah, they would hitchhike across the US, and like they had like these rules, like they couldn't you know, bring any money. They literally would just go with like a backpack with like clothes and stuff and just make it across the US. And that was like my first exposure to him. But then he started his own podcast, which I thought was like insane. It was called DVD ASA. It was him and then the porn star Asa Akira, and then Bobby Lee's younger brother would come on, and literally the most insane like podcast ever. And it eventually got canceled because he told some story and kind of stretched the truth, and lawyers got involved and they had to pull the plug. But to this day, he's still an artist. Like he's like if you follow him on Snapchat or on Instagram, like you'll see him still doing like his style of painting. And it's just like really insane to see how talented he is. And I was just curious, like how experienced are you like when it comes to actually doing stuff on canvas?
Me?
Yeah.
Not that experienced. I mean, I've done paintings, like I'm working on some paintings right now on canvases, but yeah. And then school and shit, like when I was taking painting and drawing classes, obviously there, you know, it was landing on those types of surfaces. But for me, like those types of things are more like experiments at this point, where it's like art to me doesn't solely exist like on a canvas, you know. It's like I'm really interested in fine art in the way that it applies to like everything, you know. And I think I'm like, I haven't really landed exactly on just the thing that like feels completely natural and good yet, you know. But yeah, I've certainly like tried and am trying to improve, you know, learning how to employ oil paint or whatever, you know. But the same way I'm like also trying to do that with music and video and photography and, you know, every discipline, like storytelling. Like I'm sort of searching for a way to like make sense of everything I'm interested in. So
for me,
yeah, I can't show you like a ton of canvases, but yeah, I definitely think about paintings and look at paintings a lot, like anytime on tour anymore, like if I'm on the road, like, and have a free off day or a free couple hours, like that's like the mission, is to like go to a museum or, you know, look at art.
So back home in Palm Springs, there's this annual event, or excuse me, biannual event called Desert X. And they normally time it like around the time Coachella Fest is happening. And in the Coachella Valley, there's different art installations that are sprinkled in different cities. And there's like places where you can get like the pamphlet, or you can download the app and they'll show you exactly where all the different installations are. And I feel like that's like my favorite type of art, like outside of like music. It's just like going to like a location and seeing like what the artist like built, and knowing that it's temporary, it's only going to be there for like a certain window of time, and then it's just boom, it's gone, and then just never to be seen again unless you take photos of it, which I think is like really really interesting to me. And it's just like the and I don't even like get like really deep with this stuff, like so Desert X happened last year, and like my favorite art installation was like in the middle of the desert. It was like a giant shipping container, but it was like neon like orange. And that was it. That was it. And there was just like a plaque of like, you know, the artist who did it, and that was it. And it was, you were just like, it was up to like your interpretation of like, you know, what it meant to you. And I always thought it was, that kind of stuff was like really interesting to me, because I always like to go and just kind of, you know, find meaning in stuff that, you know, could mean totally something different, but to me it's just still awesome to just look at and just think about like all the work that went into it, you know, like a giant shipping container. They painted it this neon orange and they just dropped it in the middle of the desert. It was like, you know, pretty interesting.
Yeah, it is. It sounds interesting. I thought you were going to say the, what is it? Have you ever seen the Prada like storefront that's just in the middle of the desert somewhere in like Arizona or Texas, maybe? It's just like a vacant Prada storefront in the middle of nowhere. Like, I thought that's what you're going to say. No. But yeah, conceptual art is like, it's cool. Like for that reason, because you could just, you know, someone might get something from that that the artist didn't intend whatsoever, or, you know, maybe the artist feels accomplished or whatever. But I think like, yeah, just like being able to communicate in ways beyond language and like the convention that we've come to like be comfortable with, like using social media or the internet or even just like language, having a conversation, like it's kind of limiting, I think, in a lot of ways, where you can say so much more or express so much more or just express something different with a slightly different approach, you know? So it's like, maybe some people look at that shipping container as like dumb, but someone might, you know, it might be speaking to someone in a way that words can't. And I think that's really valuable. And it's kind of like, to me, that's like the essence of art. Like when I'm trying to make art, it's like I'm communing with this force that's allowing me to express myself in ways that I'm kind of limited to typically, you know? And I think that's like a really powerful thing to try to understand and implement in your life, is that like we are so much more than like what we're defined by on a daily basis, you know? And like your mind is like this crazy force, and human history and tradition and art and music, all these things exist, and they're tools that you can use to like really express yourself in a way that feels authentic to you. And yeah, it's just like that type of philosophy, I think, is really important, especially the people that are like disenfranchised or feel like they don't have the means to succeed in a conventional way. It's like you can tap into yourself and learn a lot about yourself and maybe create a new lane or opportunity for yourself when you're kind of thinking a little bit more abstractly and yeah, just like kind of flowing a little bit more with the world in that way, and like not being so tied to your phone and the English language and these types of things.
Yeah, I felt so like I admit I'm not like an expert at art, and I remember driving out. Well, I wasn't driving. My buddy Nate was driving. Shout out Nate. We were driving out to this container, and we knew that we were going to take photos. And so we like took our photos and we were leaving. And as we were like walking out, like, you know, back to our car, like these girls were walking in and they brought props to like make it a scene. And like that just blew my mind. So I'm like, holy shit, I came out here just to take a basic photo. Like these girls like took it to the next level, brought their own props. They brought like these crazy looking chairs to make it look like, you know, they're having like a little lunch in front of like this thing. And I was just like, dude, like that's so, like in my mind, I was like, dude, that's so cool that they're just like, gonna level up their picture. And like that thought didn't even cross my mind to bring my own stuff to enhance it.
That's, yeah, that's sick. It kind of reminds me, there's this artist that I've been getting into lately named Sao Fei. She's like a Chinese artist. And okay. I'm trying to track down like the full video. I can't find it, but there's a trailer on YouTube. She has like a video called Cosplayers, where she's filming like people in cosplay like costumes in China, but she's just like stealing all the locations of like the backdrop of wherever they're at in China filming it. And it's like, yeah, it's just really, it's really sick looking. And it kind of reminded me of that, just like, yeah, there's things like, if you want to fucking make a movie, like go make a movie, like make one in your town, like go to that weird location that looks interesting to you and like make it your own, you know? Like same with like, if you have a fucking guitar or a computer or a keyboard in your house, like don't think you need some sort of like giant production or this expensive shiny thing to like make your dreams come true. Like just make it happen with what you have. And like that shit's way cooler to me to see anyway. It's just like people forging their destiny by just making it happen, you know, whatever is available, like, is in your orbit, like, it's like destiny in a way, just like, use it to get out your dreams, you know. I love that, like, sentiment about art.
So you speak about trying to find ways to express yourself, you know, outside of like language and stuff like that. Do you believe in aliens?
Yeah, but the more, like, the older I get, I think I believe in like beings in like an alternate dimension, or like, you know what I mean? I think it's more that I don't know necessarily if they're like from space, but I think if there's anything like that, it exists like in a way that we don't understand.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Joe Rogan, I'm a huge fan of Joe Rogan, and he talks about how he thinks about, you know, like the way we depict, like, you know, those gray aliens, how they just, they're just like really skinny and frail and like no real things on their body to define if they're what type of gender they are, but they have those big heads. And he always talks about how like he feels like that's like our next evolution is like we're just going to grow into that, and we're all going to be communicating telepathically, which I think is pretty crazy to think about. And I'm like, huh, like somehow that kind of like makes sense that that could happen. And
yeah,
I think about that from time to time. And sometimes like, and I hate thinking about space too much because my head begins to hurt, because, you know, they're talking about how like supermassive black holes could be gateways to other universes, and the space just it's infinite and never ends. And you just think about like, what, like we live on a planet floating in space, and space never ends. Like, what the hell? Like, it's just like, yeah, there's just so many things about it, just like makes my head hurt when I just like try to like talk to people about it.
Yeah, I kind of hate that notion of like, I mean, I'm not a flat earther, but I do like, I'm like into conspiracies, so I kind of like humor like anything that like comes across my plate, I'll like check out, you know.
Okay.
And there's like, so I think largely the flat earth movement has a lot of holes in it, you know, but the sentiment that I've like discovered that spoke to me is like this notion that the world we live in is like always trying to tell you that like we are so insignificant, you know, like we are just like this speck of dust floating throughout space, and there's like millions of possibilities and other whatever, like, yeah, other universes and alternate dimensions that like you can never fathom. And like, and in a way, it just kind of like makes you kind of accept that you're like insignificant or something. And I feel like it's like, that's the thing that I fuck with like conspiracies in some ways for, is like this notion that like, no, like maybe it's not that vast and expansive and crazy. Maybe like we are actually way more important or powerful than we like allow ourselves to accept, you know? And I think when you look at society and the way we live and the foods we eat and the way we decide to, yeah, just do basic things, it's like you're in a box inside of a box inside of a box inside of a box, like wearing socks, you know what I mean? It's like, I think human potential is like way greater than we realize. And I think in history, I mean, this is my belief, like that I think at one point maybe we were a lot more in touch with, you know, our capabilities. Like maybe we were closer to the fucking aliens that you're talking about or something. But I always like that about like giving me hope to kind of like try to tap in and get a little bit closer to like whatever you want to call it, like the universe or God or something like that. Like, I think that's important to like be empowered by like feeling significant rather than insignificant. You know what I mean? Because I don't know, it feels like a weird control mechanism to like just accept that like you're nothing, you know? I don't think that's the case. Like, I think in the grand scheme of things, like, yeah, maybe your individual story isn't like the most important thing in human history, but like I think you're alive, and I think that that counts for a lot, you know? And your ability to like make a difference in the world and communicate and love people, like I think that like goes by the wayside a little bit. Like, I think that's the thing I like about conspiracies, is to like lift up people rather than like allow them to think that like, oh, you're not, like you're nothing, and some alien's gonna come like kill you because they're smarter than you or something, you know? It's like, I think we got a lot of work to do as a species to like reach our full potential, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I get it. I'm team human all the way, just to be clear. Team human all the way. But one thing that you and I have talked about numerous times, you have like a demo that you're working on. And I was curious if you're able to talk about what new music that you're doing.
Yeah, I mean, I make music all the time, but I'm sort of like my own worst enemy with editing. And then like, I don't know, I've just been trying to like really zone in and dial in, like getting some, like trying to find my identity, I guess, as like a solo musician or whatever, you know. And I have plenty of songs that I think are good enough, but for whatever reason, it's just like this slow burning process. But I feel much more compelled recently, especially being home a lot more with the quarantine and everything, to just like finally make sense of it all. But making sense of it is like tasking, because I don't know, I think I'm just a little bit crazy about what I'm trying to do or what I'm trying to say. So it's like, I don't know, I'm a way better band member than I am like a solo artist, I'm realizing. But it's been good exercise, I think. If anything, you know, I'm like learning a lot more about producing and engineering myself, and I just don't think the time has been right. So when it happens, it'll happen and it'll be chill.
And
hopefully.
Is it going to be under the Poison Thorn moniker, or is it going to be under something else?
Yeah, Poison Thorn.
Okay.
Unless something changes, but I'm trying to like put everything under that umbrella, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Okay. And one other thing, you have some merch that's floating out there under Happy House. Do you have plans to release anything new in the near future? Because I see those hats floating around, and I'm like, man, I wish I could have came up on one of those.
Oh, sorry. You there?
Yeah, it's all good.
Yeah. So you asked about Happy House?
Yeah, I was just going back into it. I'm curious, Happy House, do you guys have any plans to release any new merch in the near future, or in the future in general?
Yeah. Yeah, Happy House is something I do with my homie Matt Decker. I'm sort of just like trying to make sense of what I've learned about like making clothes and stuff. And there's definitely like, we definitely have plans, but it's also the type of thing that I'm kind of accepting as just this like art project that will progress and like become a different thing depending on like what we're interested in or whatever. So, but yeah, there's definitely plans for like some more stuff, some more clothing and stuff like that. But that's also like an umbrella that I'm hoping to sort of funnel like different musical and art projects through. Like I'm kind of thinking of it more in that light the more time goes on, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So but yeah, there's nothing like, I mean, with being like quarantined and everything affecting businesses like that right now, it's like everything, all the clothes we make are like made in the US, so it's not really easy right now to like make anything happen. But for sure, like, yeah, that's like that, and like Poison Thorn stuff is like where like my like heart and like ambition is all at, you know. Like that's like, those are the things that I'm like trying to ultimately lift up the most. So there'll be probably more shit in the future.
Hell yeah. Well, I'm definitely looking forward to that. You know, gotta keep an eye out on the merch, because I'm definitely trying to cop a hat in the future. And
yeah, I'll send you a hat. I think I probably got one laying around here somewhere.
Hell yeah. All right, well, we can talk about that off air. But obviously I'm definitely curious about the music. I'm really looking forward to hearing that. And you know, for me to be able to sit here and talk with you, it's just kind of crazy to me, because I like, you know, obviously I can call you a friend now, but when I like take a step back and like, if I would have told my friends like in the past, like, yo, like I'm gonna do a podcast with the singer of Bad Seed, guitar player of Tile Fight, people would call me crazy. But the fact that we're sitting here and we're doing this like definitely means a lot to me.
Yeah, it means a lot to me too, man. It's a cool sounding board, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to kind of just like say stuff out loud and kind of organize my own thoughts in that way. And it's like, yeah, it's cool. It'll be a cool time capsule, I think, to like look back on. So thank you.
Okay, real quick, I want to kind of nerd out and talk about the time we hung out in Pomona, if that's okay.
Yeah, that was fun.
Yeah, so you were playing for a turnover, which was a surprise to me because I had no idea that you had that in your plans. But I remember we were talking and you had mentioned that you were playing for turnover. So I had planned to go to your LA date. I didn't even realize you were going to be playing Tropicália until you mentioned it. And I was like, holy shit. And I remember you asked me if I wanted to go to the fest, and I was like, dude, hell yeah, like I'm down, like thank you. I was like super grateful. I didn't expect too much because when somebody offers me something like that, I'm not going to get greedy and try to ask for a bunch of stuff. So when you had offered to get me into the fest, I was like super grateful for that. And when you mentioned that I had a plus one, my immediate thought was to bring like literally like one of my best friends, Garrett, because I know he's a fan of Turnover, and we were really psyched to see Fury because like we were on the fence. Like a lot of us wanted to go to see Fury on a bigger stage, but just the ticket to get him was just so expensive. So like we were both really thankful to have gotten in, you know, through you. So I appreciate that. Thank you so much. And one thing about that day that I'll never forget is like when me, you and Garrett were, you know, backstage, just like, you know, like walking around and people were stopping you left and right, like, holy shit, like, what are you doing here? And obviously people know you from the bands that you played in. And one thing that I thought was really gracious of you is that no matter who it was, and like, if I'm gonna be honest, like 90% of the people that you stopped and talked to, I had no idea who they were. You always made it a point to introduce like Garrett and I, like you didn't just leave us there as like these randoms. So I thought that was really kind of you to do that. And I definitely respected that. So thank you.
You're welcome. I feel like that's just basic humanity. Like, isn't it sad that you need to thank someone for something like that?
Yeah. It's so weird because obviously like, okay. Cause like, In like weird situations like that, there's like, you know, egos and people want to like, you know, show off that they're popular, and they want to kind of like, you know, not everybody wants to just treat people normal. Some people think they're cooler than other people, which is kind of gross to me. But to see you do that for me and Garrett, like, you know, just have that, you know, kindness, I definitely appreciate that. And it, you know, kind of showed me like, hey, this guy is like actually like a legit nice guy. He doesn't like, you know, think he's better than us or think we're just some fans that he got in. Like, you actually you know, we're down to hang out, and I appreciated that. So seriously, thank you. Like, I'll never forget that day. That day was so fun.
Yeah, well, thank you, man. You gave me a ride to downtown, right? Yeah.
Yo, yeah. Yeah,
it was, I don't know, just like, we're just the same, yo. Like, people need to stop treating each other like they're different than each other, you know what I mean? We're just the same. I know I listen to your podcast, I was a fan, and I know we have some mutual friends, and it's like we're all into hardcore and like whatever. Like, if you don't know someone, then just say what's up. Like, it's just basic shit. But yeah, thank you for thanking me for that, I guess. But yeah, it was cool. Like, yeah, it's just, I don't know, to me, like, maybe that's just something like I kind of gleaned from like touring like for so long. But it's like, we would just pull up to random towns most of the time, random countries, you know, places we didn't even know how to speak the language. And like, you just like talk to the punk and hardcore kids there that put on the show or that are chilling around the venue. And like, they just put you on to like, they take care of you. And, you know, so I think that's just kind of ingrained in like my philosophy a little bit. It's just like, I don't know, we're all the same. Like, there's no reason to be like exclusive. Like, we're at a weird indie rock festival in California. Like, I don't know, why not just try to make everybody feel comfortable and make everybody feel like they're gonna maximize their time there, you know? So it's no thing for me. And it was cool, yeah, like from that, like my kindness towards you, I guess, maybe inspired you to offer me a ride, because Tiger Jaw was playing downtown that day and I wanted to go see Tiger Jaw and my girlfriend, more importantly. So, you know what I mean? It was just like those types of things. Like, I don't know, I think about that a lot too. Like, my life, the way I live my life is like, I feel like serendipity plays this huge role, where it's just like these weird encounters kind of just float into my life, and you just kind of embrace them, and it opens doors, and like, it makes life easier in a lot of ways, and it helps shrink the world a little bit, you know? And I think that's like been to my advantage largely. So why not continue that like philosophy, you know?
Hell yeah. Well, seriously, thank you for your kindness. I appreciate you so much for being down to finally do the podcast. Before we sign off, is there anything you want to shout out or plug?
Not really. Just like, thank you for the time. Thanks to anybody that listened or supported anything I've done over the years. Super thankful. Shout out Wilkes-Barre. That's it, really.
All right. Well, seriously, thank you again. This was a pleasure. I will see you again at SWB Volume 2 in October. I'm looking forward to that.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we're going to chill. I'll take you to some spots for sure. It's going to be fun.
Hell yeah. So, all right. Well, there you guys have it. This has been an awesome episode. Thank you again for listening. This has been another episode of the JMK podcast, Always on Top.